So until the end of last week, we finished the discussion of signals, how to represent them. Basically, they are functions of times that represents a certain physical phenomena. So keep in mind that a signal is always a function, right? Cannot have multiple values at the same time. That's the condition for a function, right? And then we discussed also the properties of signals, how to classify them, and last but not least, what kind of operations you can perform either on a signal by itself, for example, time shifting, time multiplication or time scaling, amplitude shifting, amplitude scaling, inverting the time and inverting the amplitude. And we also discussed what you can perform between two signals, so adding two signals together or multiplying two signals together, right? Division, I told you, are not going to use it. So subtraction is just a sub of addition. Simply, you invert the subtracted signal and then you add it to the original one. So there is no new operation. And then we had a few examples on how you can perform combined operations, particularly between time scaling and time shifting. That was the last thing that we discussed last week. So today, if you remember from the introductory part, there are two parts for this course, a part that talks about signals and a part that talks about systems. So we need also to have a similar introduction about systems, right? How to deal with them, how to represent them, and so on, right? So today's lecture is going to be focused on systems. Okay, so now we are discussing systems, no longer signals. And as we did for signals, we will start by discussing quickly what's a system. So anyone has an answer to this? So what is a system?
A function.
Yes.
A function for signals? Signals are for signals.
Something that takes an input and processes it and gives out an output.
Yeah, so that's more or less what we are looking for. So I don't want a formal definition, right? But I want an understanding. So a system is something, as he mentioned, right? That takes an input and produces a certain output by processing that input, right? And to say this in a more formal way, we say that a system, right, is characterized by three things: its inputs, right? Sometimes we call the inputs the cause, right? This is just another naming of the input. Sometimes we call the input the cause, okay? The second thing that characterizes the system, right? Outputs, so the output from the system, and sometimes they call it the effect, okay? So I have a cause and I have an effect, something that happens because of that cause. And last but not least, right? Another important thing is called rules of operation, right? What does it do to the input to produce the output? These are rules of operations. Sometimes they call them the governing laws, right? Or the model, okay? So three things characterizes a system. The inputs to the system, because whenever you change the input, the output is gonna change, right? So the input characterizes the system. The output, because for the same input, two systems might produce a different output, right? And then the last thing, but not least, are the rules of operation. How does this system operate on the input to produce the output, okay? These are the laws that are governing the system. So typically, in represententing systems graphically and how they interact with systems, we use block diagram representation, right? Block diagram representation. And in that kind of representation, the block diagram representation, we represent our system as a box, a rectangular box, right? Which has certain inputs, right? So some inputs goes into that box and has some outputs going out of the box. And sometimes we put on the box itself the governing laws by simply calling them a function. So sometimes we call it h of t as a time domain representation of the operation. So that h of t is a representation of what the system performs. Sometimes we write the operation directly. So we say, for example, this is a system that takes the magnitude square. So rather than saying h of t, we simply say, okay, inside the box here, we say magnitude square of the input, right? So, and that's what we do, right? So this tells us that this system takes the input, squares its magnitude, and produces that as the output. Or sometimes you use, like, right, multiplication. So this system multiplies two different inputs, right? The inputs could be multiple. The outputs also could be multiple from a particular system. So you can have more than one input to the system, and you can have more than one output from the same system, okay? And you can have interconnection of systems, right? So I can end up with some block diagram that shows something like this, right? And even interconnection with feedback, right? So, and this is system one, this is system two, and my output is here, and my input is here, right? So this is interconnection. Again, interconnection doesn't have to have feedback, right? It can be simply series interconnection. So I have multiple systems connected together in series, or maybe parallel interconnection. So I have one system connected in parallel with another system, connected in parallel with a third system, and so on, right? And all of these are added together. So all the outputs are added together here, right? So in that case, this is a simple parallel interconnection. It could be series. So the output of one goes into the input, or a mix of all of these, right? It can be complicated. It includes feedback, right? It includes series and parallel connection, right? So this is series. This is parallel. And this is feedback. Okay? And you can have a mix of all of these interconnections. All of these are called interconnections. This is an interconnection, this is another interconnection, this is a third one, or you can have a mix of all of these, okay? These are system interconnections. Now, if you want to represent systems in short, right, we can only represent them by an arrow rather than the block diagram. So sometimes we simply represent systems by putting an arrow here and saying this is the input, this is the output, right? And in this case, we don't look at the rules of the system. We are only concerned about the inputs and the outputs from that system, right? And we don't put a block diagram, and that's the same equivalence. So if a system here, for example, is performing a squaring, then this, in this arrow case, is going to be input, and the output is gonna be simply input, right? Magnitude squared, right? So rather than saying input, output, I would say input, and then on the other side, I would say magnitude squared of the input. So x of t, magnitude squared of x of t, and so on, right? Connected together by an arrow. So this tells me that there is, within this arrow, there is some system that performs the operation of taking the magnitude and squaring it, okay? So that's another representation of a system, right? Or a simple representation. This is simple. Right, input, output, representation. Okay, so just we are talking here still about definitions, right? How to characterize a system and then how to represent it graphically if you need to. Yes?
What does the circle mean?
This circle here?
Yeah.
It's a system. You can think of it again as a square, but this system is performing addition. So it takes this as a positive and this one as a negative, right? Similarly here, it's an addition, but all of them are positive, okay? So that's just one of the common systems. The circle represents an additive system, a system that adds the inputs together, regardless of how many inputs. Now, if some of them are positive and some are negative, it will be an addition and subtraction as well, right? Sometimes also we have a circle and an X inside, which means it is a multiplier. Whatever inputs goes into that are multiplied together. Yes.
System input is signal and output signal. Yes.
Both inputs and outputs are signals. Yes. Okay. Any other questions about quickly how we represent a system and yes.
For every input, there is only one output.
No, not necessarily. It might be that one output is dependent on many of the inputs. Not necessarily. For every input, there is one output. It can be that you have multiple inputs and they are combined somehow. For example, the summation system, right? You have multiple inputs and you produce only a single output, right?
Yeah.
Assume you have another system which is performing two operations on the input, right? One operation is adding them and producing the addition, and another operation is multiplying them. So I'll have one system which is taking multiple inputs, let's say five, and two outputs. One output will produce the sum, and the other output is going to produce the multiplication. So there is no relation between the number of inputs and outputs. It can be anything.
If there is one input and two outputs.
Yeah, it can be that you take one input. Yeah, you can take one input, and one output is like squaring the input. The other one is taking the square root, right?
And here it is a function.
Yes, yes.
One input and two outputs.
Yes. Not a function, a system. A system is not a function. Okay? A function is the signal. A signal is a function. Yes. A system is not a function. A system is an entity that can perform operations on the input to produce the output. Whatever the number of inputs is, and whatever the number of outputs is. Okay? Any other questions? Okay. So this is in terms of like feeling systems. Okay? Now let's try to look at what we will study about systems. So our study of systems, right, will include three things. Okay, number one, mathematical modeling. Simply, how to represent the input output relation, or what we call the laws, i.e. right, the laws that govern the system, how we can represent them mathematically, right? So mathematical modeling is our first focus on this part. There is another one which is based on mathematical modeling as well as representation of signals. We can perform system analysis, right? And then you expect what's going to be the third part. If we can analyze something, our next step is going to be able to design, right? So the third thing is going to be design. So let's call them A, B, and C. Design. Okay. Now in this course, in the course of signals and systems, most of the focus is going to be spent, or most of the time is going to be spent on mathematical modeling and analysis. We will lightly touch upon design, but the study of full design operations goes to other courses, which are not part of the core curriculum, but might be all an elective course or might be some advanced course in your future, right? Here, we are teaching you the important tools so you can represent mathematical representation or modeling of a system and analyze a system based on its mathematical model, okay? In order to move towards design, you can implement some of this knowledge later on when you do, for example, your senior design project, if it has to do with signals and systems. We will give you a few examples, but we will not rigorously study how to design a system in this course. Okay? Any questions about this? So mathematical modeling, analysis versus design. Yes?
So designing is like, we'll make the circuit for the...
You know the input-output requirements, you know what you need to do for a particular input, what kind of output you need to produce, and it's your role to figure out how the system should look like to perform this operation, right? So not in terms of the model, because you will be able to know the model of the system once you know the input-output relation, but how to implement that model into an actual system. So that's the design of a system, okay?
So like hardware?
Doesn't matter whether it's hardware or software, but basically breaking down its operation into pieces, right? That's how you, pieces that can be implemented, right? That's how you design something, okay? And we're not gonna focus heavily on that part. Again, design is something, implementation is something else. So whether it becomes a hardware or a software, that's an implementation detail. But the design is what kind of detailed operations this system needs to perform such that it gives me that particular output for that particular input, okay? So that's the design, okay? Any other questions? So basically, when you do analysis, what's given to you is going to be the system model, okay? And your function, your operation, or your job is going to be, give me all the characteristics of this system. So you have the model. If you have this input, what's going to be the output, right? If I do that to the input, what's going to be the effect on the output, and so on. This is analysis, okay? The characteristics of the systems and so on. While when you do design, you don't have the system mathematical model. You have the input and the required output, and your job is to figure out the detailed mathematical model in that case, okay? And that's part of the design operation, okay? While in the case of mathematical modeling, again, you have input-output relation, right? And you know exactly how does this relation should happen, and your job is to map it into a math model, okay? Any questions? So let's move on. Next step. So as we did before, okay, we will start in a minute talking about different properties of systems that allows us to classify them, right? And then the last step is going to be the first or the like the first intuitive mathematical modeling of a system, which is called the input-output relation, okay? Then next lecture, inshallah, we will move to a particular category of systems. That's the one that we will focus on for the rest of this course, and we'll see how we can have a better mathematical representation for that particular category of systems. So before going into the characteristics of the system, okay, I'm going to discuss quickly that input-output relation of a system, okay? So input, sorry. Input-output relation in details. And let me start this by an example. And I think the example is relevant to you whether you are computer engineering or electrical engineering. Remember the RC circuit when you have a resistor and a capacitor, right? So if I have an RC circuit, resistor and a capacitor, and I'm providing the system has an input here, which is input voltage, right? So this is voltage, would be positive and negative, right? And I'm interested in, for example, the output of this system can be either the voltage over the capacitor, or it can be, I can be interested only on the current flowing through the system. So the output is gonna be my current. So I have the input as the voltage, and I want to calculate the current going through this circuit. So who remembers what was the relation?
First, you want
the voltage of the current, right? Yes.
So I have to know the type of the input.
What's the general relation between the voltage and the current on this circuit?
Ohm's law.
Yeah. What's Ohm's law in this case? Give me the relation.
Okay, V is equal the current at this point times the resistance,
okay,
of this resistance plus the current times the voltage at the capacitor.
I don't know the voltage at the capacitor.
Impedance of the capacitor.
Impedance, but yes. Impedance, you assumed in this case that this system is already operating under sinusoidal at steady state, right? But I didn't say so.
Not really.
No. There is a more general relation. This is a relation only for sinusoidal at steady state, right?
Okay.
What's the general relation for an RC circuit?
CD.
Yeah, exactly. The relation says that the current, how do you get the current and how you get the voltage and how you relate them? What's the current in the resistor?
Okay, resistor.
Yeah, assuming that a current I is flowing in this circuit, okay? What's going to be the voltage across the resistor? What's going to be the voltage across the capacitor? Okay, so V, which is the voltage at the input, right, is equal to the voltage across this plus the voltage across this, right? So this is equal to I multiplied by R plus what?
CdV
by dt, but I want it in terms of current.
Q equals CV.
Okay. So 1 over C multiplied by the integral from minus infinity up to time t, right? So I'm looking at the voltage at time t as a function of the current at time t, right? So the integral from minus infinity up to time t, the current at time t multiplied, integrated with respect to time, right? And it's multiplied by 1 over C, right? So this is the relation that governs the voltage and the current on this circuit, right? Okay? Now notice that in order to calculate the voltage at any point in time, right, I had to use the current all the way from minus infinity up to the current time that I want to calculate at, right? Typically, you are given a current, for example, or an input to this system, which starts at time t equals 0, for example, right? So what happens to that integration from minus infinity up to 0? No. So let's start. First, you can break this into IR, right, plus, so I of t multiplied by R, plus 1 over C integral from minus infinity up to 0, I of t dt, plus integral from 0 up to time t, right, I of t dt.
It's not zero, it depends on the previous state of the circuit.
Like if it's and I said now zero, and I give the example of zero. Okay. Okay. So I multiplied by R plus 1 over C, the integral from minus, because I told you you are given the time at t equals zero and up, right? So the initial condition here is zero.
Okay.
Right? It can be at any other generalized point t. Okay? So minus integration from minus infinity to zero, I of t dt. Plus the integration from 0 to t, I of t. This is the one that you are given. You are given I of t from t equals 0 up to any point in time. What about all the previous ones? You can say that all these, all this is equivalent to the initial charge at the capacitor, right? This is the initial charge. How much charge this capacitor has as time 0, at time 0, this is going to be my initial condition, right? So there are two components here, right? There is this and this, which basically depends on the input, right? And there is this part which depends on the initial condition, right? So these two together depends on the input, which is given to you from t equals zero up to whatever time you are interested in. And there is another part of this equation that depends on the past, and that part I summarize it by what was my initial condition at time t equals 0, right? Then the output from any system, right? Output of a system, right? Is composed of two important components, right? One of the components is called the initial condition, right? Or we call it zero input component, right? Because you can get the initial, if you assume that the input goes to zero, these two will go to zero. If you assume that I of t is equal to zero, from zero all the way up to t, right? Then these two will go to zero, and you remain only with the initial condition, right? So the initial condition, which is zero input response, or the output that results from zero input, and then the second part is called zero initial condition component, zero initial condition component, or the input component, input response, right? So this one is called zero input response, and this one is called input response, assuming that the initial condition was equal. So you set this to zero, and you remain only with the two ones that result from the input. So you can divide the output, the response that you get from a system for a particular input, into two parts. One part that depends on what was the start point of the system, right? Even if you are dealing with a mechanical system, right? If you have a lever, for example, okay? And you push it with a certain force and you want to get its position after a certain time, right? You have to know where did it start from. That's the initial condition. Might have started from here, might have started from here, might have started from down, all the way up, right? So the start point is going to affect the final result that you will get at time t, right? So that's the initial condition. And then there is another part which is has to do with how much force you put and for how long in terms of time, right? That part is the input part, okay? And you can divide the output into two parts, part that comes from the initial condition, another part that comes from the input only, okay? When you want to get the one that comes from the initial condition, you set the input to zero. And when you want to get only the outcome from the input, then you set the initial conditions to zero, right? Okay, so you assume, for example, that if I want to get only the effect of the input, I will assume that my lever started from vertical position, that's my position zero, right? And then I can figure out how much it's affected by the input, right? And if I want to get the initial condition, I set the input to zero, and I see where is the lever actually. Combining those two should give me the actual output, given that the initial condition is a particular value and the input is a particular value, okay? This is clear to everyone, okay? I didn't say how you combine them yet. I said you should combine those two to get the output. How you combine them, we will come to it later, okay? Any questions about this important note? This is kind of a note, how you can figure out the output for a particular system, and that it depends on two important parameters, the initial condition of the system as well as the input to the system. Okay? Any questions? Clear. Good. Nice. Let's move to categorizing system, and then as part of that, we will come back to this combining initial condition and input effects on a system. So classification. Of systems, or you can think of this as system properties, because you classify them according to their properties, right? It's the same thing. If you are talking about system properties or classification of systems, you are talking about certain properties of a system that allows you to classify systems into different categories, okay? So the first thing is linear system versus non-linear systems. Okay, so whether a system is linear or not. There are two properties for a system to be linear. As I did, by the way, for signals, I'm going to cover this part by going through examples. Okay, so a linear system must satisfy two important properties. Number one, number A, it must be additive. Okay, and number B, it must be homogeneous. So what each one of those mean or represent, okay? An additive system means that, and I'm not going to use the arrow notation to represent systems now, okay? An additive system means that if I have X1 as an input, and the output for that input is given by Y1 of T, and if I have X2 as an input, and I measure the output, I find it to be Y2 of T, right? This is F, okay? Then, for this system, if I put X1 plus X2 as an input, I should get, as an output, Y1 of T plus Y2 of T, okay? So, if, for a particular system, an input of X1, a certain function at the input, a certain signal, produces a signal at the output, I call it Y1 of T. And if I change the input and make it some other input, call it X2 of T, and this produces an output Y2 of T, then if I put as an input the sum of those two, I should get as an output the sum of those two outputs, right? Okay, that's called additive. Let's talk about homogeneous. Again, if the input to a system, call it X of T, produces a certain output Y of T, then, right, if I put at the input a scaled version of X of T, so it's scaled by a constant A, I should get the same output Y of T scaled by the same value A. Okay, this is called the homogeneity of a system. Okay, again, if I put, for example, a sinusoid with amplitude 1, and I'm getting out of this system the same sinusoid, as it is shifted with, let's say, pi over 2, so the system performs only a shift, right? Then if the input is going to be a sinusoid of amplitude A, I'm going to get the output, the same sinusoid shifted with the same shift, right? That was here, but scaled with A, right? So scaling the input with a particular value scales the output with the same value without doing any other effect to the output. That's called the homogeneity property, okay? If a system satisfies both, then the system is linear. If it violates one or both of them, then it's nonlinear, okay? So to prove that a system is linear, right? To prove linearity, okay? You must check both, right? Both properties, which are the homogeneity and the additivity, right? Okay? However, to prove non-linearity, it's sufficient to do what? Yeah, to show that one of them is not satisfied, right? To prove non-linearity, it's sufficient to show that one is not satisfied. Okay. So you are checking whether a system is linear or not. You check the first property and you find it's not satisfied. No need to check the second one. You can immediately tell me that at that point the system is nonlinear, right? But if the first was satisfied, you have to also check the second. If the second is satisfied as well, then the system is linear. If the second is not satisfied, then the system is nonlinear, right? Okay. Let's take an example, and it's a nice example, by the way. So example, okay. You have a system which has the input-output relation, right? System S, which is represented by the input-output relation dy of t by dt. That's y, where y is the output. Typically, in this course, we represent the output by the function y and the input by the function x, right? But sometimes we might change the names of the functions. It's fine, as long as you are told what's the input and what's the output, okay? So dy by dt plus 3 y of t is equal to x of t. So this is the input-output relation where y is output and x of t is input to the system, okay? So again, the relation between the input and the output of this system follows a differential equation relation, right? So it's similar to that capacitor which follows an integral equation relation, right? So the relation here follows a differential equation. Now, you don't need to solve the differential equation. Some of you might not have taken yet the course on that. It doesn't matter. I'm not going to ask you to solve the differential equation. It's only that if you know the basics of differentiation, you should be able to tell me whether this system is linear or not. How can you approach that? So show me whether this system is linear or not. So how can you approach that? You need to test the two properties, linearity and, the two linearity properties, the additive and homogeneity, right? So let's start by additive. Okay, check if additive, okay? That's the first check that you will do. So what you will do in this case, you will say, for assuming that for input x1, I get as an output y1 of t. And for input x2 of t, I get y2 of t, okay? So applying this to the equation means that for input x1, what's going to be the equation? So for x1, what's going to be the system equation? D, because for x1, the output is called y1, right? So dy1 of t by dt plus 3y1 of t is equal to x1 of t, right? And then for x2?
So dy2
of t? Yeah, dy2 of t by dt plus 3y2 of t is equal to x2 of t, right? So these are the two system equations under input x1 and under input x2. Assuming that we call the output for the first one y1, and we call the output for the second one y2, right? So applying it up to the equation here, we get these two equations, okay? Add the two equations together, what you will get?
You will get dy1.
So let's go, I will move to the next slide, okay? Because this slide is finished. So if I add them together, what do I get? I write the two equations again for you, x1 of t and for x2 of t. Right. So dy1 of t by dt plus 3y1 of t is equal to x1 of t. And the second equation, dy2 of t by dt plus 3y2 of t is equal to x2 of t. If I add those two together, what do I get?
dy1.
I have dy1 of t by dt plus dy2 of t by dt plus 3y1 of t plus 3y2 of t, and this is equal to x1 of t plus x2 of t, right? Now, if I look at the right-hand side, this happens when I add the two inputs together, right? Because I have x1 plus x2, right? What happens to the right-hand side, the left-hand side? We can aggregate things together. So what you will get when you aggregate things, you can say d by dt of y1 of t plus y2 of t, right? Plus 3 multiplied by y1 of t plus y2 of t. And this is equal to x1 of t plus x2 of t, right?
Yes.
Now, if I go and look at, this is the input-output relation that I got for the case of, right, aggregating the two outputs, right? In case adding the two outputs or adding the two inputs together, okay? Now, if I go to the original definition and apply an input equal to x1 plus x2 into the system equation, what would be the result?
The same.
Exactly the same as this, right? So this means that the system satisfies, okay, so applying or assuming, or simply by looking at this equation, right, you can just cut simply by looking at equation. Let's call it A. We see that right. For input x1 plus x2 of t, right, we have y1 plus y2 of t, right? Which means that the system satisfies the additive, right? What happens to homogeneity? So this is all for the additive. Second, okay, check. Homogeneous. But here, system is additive. Okay? So what, check the homogeneity. What should I do for the homogeneity? Only one of these equations and try to multiply the input by A and see what happens to the output, right? So if I multiply the input by A, it's equivalent. If I look at that, if I multiply this by A, I should multiply A on both sides such that the equation stays true, right?
Exactly.
So multiplying
by constant
input by a constant A, we get, okay, AX1, for example, of T, and it's equal to multiplying all the other side by A. So A, right, multiplied by dy1 by dt plus 3y1 of t, right? Now, taking that A and applying it inside the square brackets, I will end up with what? Which leads to, this leads to d, and then you have ay1 of t, right?
Dt.
By dt plus 3 multiplied by ay1 of t, right, is equal to A X1 of T, right? Now this is the output from the systems by definition, and this is the input. And then we can notice again from this equation that for a scaled input with value A, the output was also scaled by the same value A, okay? So this is the output from the definition of the system equation, and this is the input. So we can see that the system is homogeneous, right? And because it's homogeneous and it is additive, then the system is linear, right? Because it satisfies both properties. If one of them came to us to be untrue, we stop there and the system is not linear, right? Okay, any questions? Yes?
When it's not additive?
Nam?
When it's not additive?
When it's not additive? If you add the inputs and you don't end up with the outputs added. Are you looking for an example of a non-additive system? Okay, let's look at an example. So here's an example of non... Nam?
Okay.
Non-additive system. Okay? Y of T is equal to X of T squared. This is the relation between the input and the output, right? Okay? Now assume that for this system, okay, for X1 I get Y1 and for X2 I get Y2, okay? So if I put X1 plus X2, what's going to be the result? So for X1 of T, I assume that the output is Y1 of T. So this is assumed. So we start always by this assumption for the additivity check. And for X2 as an input, I get Y2 of T, okay? Now let's try to put X1 plus X2. What's going to be the output in that case? So Y, okay, for Y of T, for X1 of T plus X2 of T. Is equal to what? Instead of X, I will put X1 of T plus X2 of T, and then the whole thing is square. This is equal to what? X1 of T squared plus, right? Plus X2 squared plus 2 X1 of T multiplied by X2 of T, okay? Now, try to tell me what's gonna be Y1 plus Y2. Y1 is equal to what? Y1 of T is equal to what? It's the output when the input is X1, right?
X1.
So Y1 is equal to X1, X1 of T squared. What's Y2?
X2.
It's equal to X2 of T squared. When you add them, what do you get? Y1 of T plus Y2 of T is equal to what? X1 of T squared plus X2 of T squared. Is this the same? This is the output. This is what you get, sorry, an expression for Y1 plus Y2, right? And this is what you get. This whole thing is what you get when the input is X1 plus X2. Is this equal to this? No. So this means that this system is not additive. When you added two inputs, right, you got some expression for the output which is different from adding the two outputs, right? So this system is non-additive. Okay? So there are cases where you will find that the system is non-additive. Similarly, for homogeneity, the same system is not homogeneous, by the way. Because if you multiply the input by A, you will get A squared times X squared, right? When you multiply the output by A, you will get A times X squared. So the scaling is different. So again, it's also non-homogeneous, right? You can have all the variations, right? Non-homogeneous but additive, non-additive but homogeneous, or non-non, or both are additive and homogeneous, which is the case of linear system. Clear, jama'a, linearity? Now, for a linear system, and probably this is what we will stop at today, for a linear system, okay, the relation of zero input. I told you we'll come back to this later, right? And zero initial condition. To total response, or the total system response, right? Of each one of those is response, right? So zero input response, zero initial condition response, okay? And how it relates to total response is given by total, it's a linear relation in that case, right? Total response is equal to zero input response. This is what we called the initial condition, right? Zero input response is the initial condition. Okay. Plus input response, right? Which is the zero initial condition. Zero initial condition. So the relation becomes, you need to combine those two, the zero input response and the zero initial condition, or the one that comes from the initial condition plus the one that comes from the input only. You combine them by adding them together such that you get the total output. If the system is linear. If the system is not linear, the combination is not by simple addition. There is a more complicated combination depending on how the system looks like. Why do we care that much about linear systems? Because linear systems, number one, they exist typically. So that's a couple of notes. We still have like a minute and a half. So linear systems, okay, are much better, yes, or easy to deal with using generalized modeling. So we can find general modeling techniques for linear systems. But if a system is nonlinear, for every system, you need a different modeling approach because they don't have general characteristics that governs them, right? While linear systems have very nice general characteristics that allows you to use one method to model all of them. Doesn't mean that they will have the same model, but it's one method to model them. Okay? Okay. So that's one thing. And the other thing is that typically all, and maybe I've touched upon this in your electronics course, typically all physical systems are almost linear, okay, when the input is small, right? So you have that small signal analysis thing, right?
Yeah.
For small inputs, the system is mostly very close to linear, so you can deal with it as linear. When the input becomes very large, you can linearize by specifying the region that you work on, right? And in that particular small region, you can still deal with the system as linear. But if you deal with a very large range, then the system is no longer linear, right? So these are the nice properties of linear systems, and that's why we care about them that much. Next time, we'll study another important property of the system, which is called time invariance. And then we'll study other properties of the system very quickly. They are not much involved like these two, right? And the last thing is we will talk about the simple modeling way, and we'll also give you an idea what's going to be the focus of the course. The rest of the course is going to, after this part, is going to focus on linear and time invariant systems. Okay, so all the rest of the study of the course is going to focus on systems that possesses those two properties, the linearity that we discussed today and the time invariance that we will discuss next time, inshallah. Okay.